Shalom. My name is Adam, and I welcome you to the Parable of the Vineyard. Every day, Yahuwah is waking up a remnant, a group of people who are coming out of deceptions, realizing our walk is to consist of faith and obedience to His righteous commands. Each week, we read through and examine a portion of the Torah, allowing the Spirit of the Most High to guide, teach, and open our eyes and ears to the wondrous matters out of His law. Join us as we seek to be refined by His word, preparing ourselves for the return of our King of Kings, being faithful and obedient, walking in His way, truth, and life. Shabbat shalom and welcome back, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Parable of the Vineyard YouTube live stream of our Torah portion reading. My name is Adam, your host, and I welcome you. This is week 39, Chukat, which includes Numbers 19 through 22, verse 1. And this is a really special Torah portion. And the reason I say that is because there's a couple things that we're doing, at least what I'm doing when I go through the Torah portions, is number one, you know, I think I'm in a place where it's like, I want to go through your Torah, Father, and show me what we can keep. We realize that we can't keep all of it. You know, some of the laws are for women only, some are for priests only, some are for farmers only, so on and so forth. But it's like, we go through it, it's like, what can we keep, you know? That's number one. Number two, I love going through here and seeing Messiah, seeing His offering for us. And this week we'll see the red heifer, and we're going to see the serpent on the brazen serpent, which is right there. We're gonna see how that related to Messiah and foreshadowed Messiah, and he even quotes it in John 3. You know, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up. And so this Torah portion we get to being the red heifer and the bronze serpent on a pole. So we get to see our Messiah clearly in this Torah portion. And if you haven't ever heard about the crimson worm, just get ready. I mean, this should be, I hope this Torah portion is a blessing for you. Let's pray. Father, Yahuwah Sebaot, we come before You in Your Son's name, Messiah Yahusha, whom we love and we know, Father, came for us. We know that He's not just some made-up figure. We know that He is true. He came and offered Himself up on the tree for us, Father, for our sins. We gladly accept Him as our Messiah and our teacher and our master, Father. And we just thank You so much for the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, Father, that You've put within us to convict us of sin and to guide us into all truth. We owe everything to You, and we bless You in Yahusha's name. We love You, Abba. Amen. All right, little shofar, and then we'll get started. All right, here we are at the end of the Torah portion. Why are we at the end of the Torah portion? Let's go to the beginning of the Torah portion. Chapter 19 of Numbers. Laws for purification. And Yahuwah spoke unto El Moshe and unto El Aharon, saying, this is the ordinance of the Torah, which Yahuwah has commanded, saying, speak unto the children of Yisrael, that they bring you a red heifer without spot, wherein is no blemish, and upon which never came yoke. And we know that Messiah is the unspotted one. No blemish, no sin was found in, and upon which never came a yoke. And the bondage of sin is sometimes said as the yoke of sin or the bondage of sin. So we know that he is this no blemish and never came the yoke of sin upon him. And ye shall give her unto Eleazar the priest, that he may bring her forth without the camp, and one shall slay her before his face. And Eleazar the priest shall take of her blood with his finger and sprinkle of her blood directly before the tabernacle of the assembly 7 times. There just seems to be something about this 7 times thing. It reminds me of like Naaman with the cleansing of leprosy. He had to bathe 7 times. We see the sprinkling of the blood 7 times for cleansing. It's just interesting. And one shall burn the heifer in his sight, and her skin, and her flesh, and her blood, and with her dung shall he burn. And the priest shall take cedar wood. Now listen to these ingredients. Cedar wood and hyssop and scarlet. And this is a very special Hebrew word here that we're going to dig into here in a minute. Taula. And cast it into the midst of the burning of the heifer. Then the priest shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in water. And afterward he shall come into the camp, and the priest shall be unclean until the evening. So we're going to come back to verse 6 in just a bit. We're going to explain the red heifer sacrifice and how it relates to Messiah, undoubtedly, at least in my opinion, of course. And he that burns her shall wash his clothes in water, and bathe his flesh in water, and shall be unclean until the evening. And a man that is clean shall gather up the ashes of the heifer, and lay them up without the camp in a clean place. And it shall be kept for the assembly of the children of Yisrael for a water of separation. It is a purification for sin. And we know that Messiah is our sin sacrifice, and he fulfills that in multiple ways. And we're going to see that again today. And this is why this Torah portion is extremely special. And he that gathers the ashes of the heifer shall wash his clothes and be unclean until the evening. And it shall be unto the children of Yisrael and unto the stranger that sojourns among them for a statute forever. He that touches the dead body of any man shall be unclean 7 days. So it's interesting. We emphasize forever many times, you know, when we go through the Sabbath, the feast days. And it's like, okay, well, you know, and people that mock at us will kind of be, well, quote this and be like, well, red heifer forever. Hello. Well, in these cases, in these instances, we covered this greatly in the book of Leviticus. Specifically, if you want to learn about Messiah and the sacrifices and how he fulfilled them and how we don't have to do sacrifices anymore, at least at this time, then please look at the Torah portion Vayikra, and we go through it in great detail and show you all throughout the prophets how he prophesied, not that the law would be done away with, but that he would put away the shedding of blood, the sacrifice for sins, the sacrifice of animals, innocent animals for sins, that he would eventually do away with that. And that's what Paul talks about in Galatians, how that was added for transgression's sake and kept until that time that the seed should come, and he came, Messiah. So we'll talk about that here just a little bit. But if you really want to understand how Messiah covers us for the red heifer sacrifice, even to this day, we're going to talk about that, but in a spiritual sense of how he fulfills the sacrifice for us even right now in the heavenlies. Please take a look at Torah portion Vayikra, because that's something that we need to dig in for like another hour, and we're not going to do that in this Torah portion. So, and on all the Torah portions, we have the Torah portion playlist. You can click on that link and you can see all the Torah portions there on that list. He that touches the dead body of any man shall be unclean 7 days. He shall purify himself with it on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean. So it's interesting that he gets purified on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean, but if he purify not himself on the third day, then the seventh day he shall not be clean. And we'll talk about that here just for a second. Some interesting wording here with third day and seventh day. I want to show you about being cleansed on the third day. We see that here in Exodus 19, right before the giving of the commandments on Mount Sinai. Yahweh said unto Moshe, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes and be ready against the third day. So they're supposed to wash their clothes and be ready for the third day. For the third day, Yahweh will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. And you shall set bounds unto the people round about, saying, take heed to yourselves that you go not up into the mount, or touch the border of it. Whosoever touches the mount shall be surely put to death. There shall not an hand touch it, but he shall surely be stoned, or shot through, whether it be beast or man, it shall not live. When the trumpet sounds long, they shall come up to the mount. And Moshe went down from the mount unto the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. And he said unto the people, be ready against the third day. Come not at your wives. And we'll just stop there. We'll read here Exodus 24:15-16. And Moshe went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called unto Moshe out of the midst of the cloud. Right? So we see that kind of a third day, seventh day symbology. But here in Hosea, we see something really interesting pointing to our Messiah. So remember, before we read this, that a day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. Come, let us return unto Yahuwah, for he has torn, and he will heal us. He has smitten, and will bind us up. And we know that the testimony of Yahushua, the ministry of Yahushua, was to bind us up, to bind up the brokenhearted, right? To heal, to set the captives free, to heal. By his stripes we are healed. After 2 days he will revive us. In the third day he will raise us up and shall live in his sight. So what's interesting is, after 2 days. So if the timeline is correct, and I know there's some speculation that we can't trust the year 2022 that we're in right now, but if we are roughly 2,000 years removed from Messiah, so we are at the end of 2 days. So after 2 days, so at the end of 2 days, he will revive us. In the third day, he will raise us up. So if we're at the end of the second day and getting ready to begin the third day from Messiah's cleansing, so if we're cleansed by him, right, and if we're going back here, he shall purify himself with it on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean. So what's interesting is there's some parallels here, is because if we're 2,000 years from Messiah, so we're at the end of, sorry, if you think about it, if, let's say, 1,000 years after Messiah, that's the end of the first day going into the second day. And then, let's say, year 1,001 to kind of where we are now, roughly, is at the end of the second day. We're at the beginning of the third day. And if we are at the end times, like a lot of people think, he will raise us up, you know, the resurrection on the third day, and we shall live in his sight. That's amazing, right? And if you think about it, if you think about this being purified on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean. Now think about this. Think about going, if the resurrection happens on the third day from Messiah, which is, you know, roughly where we are now. We know that, oh, at least some people would say that Messiah was 4,000 years from Adam. So if we're at the end of 6 days as total, and this is beginning the seventh day, which is the millennial reign, we see some things here. So we see that if we're not cleansed on the third day, you know, and on the seventh day we shall be clean. And if we can't, it says no unclean thing shall go into New Jerusalem. So regardless of any Torah keeping, any commandment keeping, if we don't have the cleansing of this red heifer, we won't be clean. And we won't be clean on the seventh day. And we won't be ready to go in. But if he purified not himself the third day, then the seventh day he shall not be clean. So without Messiah, there is no getting in. If he's the red heifer sacrifice, which I'd like to clarify that he is, and we'll do that in just a moment. We'll go back to Numbers 19:6 in just a moment, and I want to show you undoubtedly that Messiah is the red heifer sacrifice, and without him, you're not getting into New Jerusalem. Numbers 19:13, whosoever touches the dead body of any man that is dead and purifies not himself, defiles the tabernacle of Yahuwah, and that soul shall be cut off from Yashrael. Because the water of separation was not sprinkled upon him, he shall be unclean. His uncleanness is yet upon him. This is the Torah. When a man dies in a tent, all that come into the tent and all that is in the tent shall be unclean 7 days. And every open vessel which has no covering bound upon it is unclean. And whosoever touches one that is slain with a sword in the open field, or a dead body, or a bone of a man, or a grave, shall be unclean 7 days. And this is interesting for you Nazirites out there. This shows you that, you know, if you don't touch a dead body, but you're in the same room as someone that just dies, that's not good news for a Nazirite. But it's here, every open vessel which has no covering bound upon it is unclean. This is really interesting because I know some people that have understood or known have known people that are in witchcraft or studied it, you know, and what they do is they'll take open vessels and they'll go to like a funeral and they'll keep the open vessel there and then they'll like close it and bring it back, and they use that for like spells and incantations. It's crazy. And this is why Yah is like, every open vessel has no covering is unclean, right? And whosoever touches one that is slain with a sword in the open fields, or a dead body, or a bone of a man, or a grave, shall be unclean. So in the open field, outside of a room, if you don't touch it, you're okay. And for an unclean person, they shall take of the ashes of the burnt heifer of purification for sin, and running water shall be put thereto in a vessel. And a clean person shall take hyssop and dip it in the water and sprinkle it on the tent, upon all the vessels and upon the persons that were there, and upon him that touched a bone, or one slain, or dead, or a grave. And the clean person shall sprinkle upon the unclean the third day, and on the seventh day, and on the seventh day he shall purify himself and wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and shall be clean at evening. This reminds me of baptism in conjunction with what's going on here. Let's take a look here. Mark 16. And he said unto them, go you into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And he that believes and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believes not shall be damned. Matthew 28:18-20. And Yahushua came and spoke unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Ruach HaKodesh, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So it's, you know, baptism is not optional. This is required. Ezekiel 36:25-28. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you. So we're talking about this sprinkling the water, right? I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. And this is the water of the purification, right? So not just baptism, but also the red heifer sacrifice needs to be upon us. And Messiah Yahushua performed that for us. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my judgments and my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your Elohim. And this is coming. And this is coming. We'll actually move on from that one. I think there's one I missed here. Yeah. Matthew 17:23, and they shall kill him, and on the third day he shall be raised again. So can you think about that? We know that literally he rose third day, but what about the third day after, you know, if a day is 1,000 years and 1,000 years is a day? Hopefully I'm not going too fast for you on that. Back to Numbers, verse 20. But the man that shall be unclean and shall not purify himself, that soul shall be cut off from among the assembly, because he has defiled the sanctuary of Yahuwah. The water of separation has not been sprinkled upon him. He is unclean. No unclean thing will go into New Jerusalem. And it shall be a perpetual statute unto them that the sprinkles of the water of separation shall wash his clothes, and he that touches the water of separation shall be unclean until the evening. And whatsoever the unclean person touches shall be unclean, and that soul that touches it shall be unclean until the evening. So, I want to go back here to Numbers 19:6 and show you that Messiah is the red heifer. So we saw that, you know, he was without spot or blemish, and no yoke of sin came upon him. And the priest shall take cedar wood. A lot of people would say that the cross that he was nailed to was cedar wood. Now, hyssop is important, and scarlet. And we're gonna study this real quickly. So what's interesting right here is this word scarlet. We're gonna take a look at the Strong's Concordance on this. So we're gonna see this in Numbers 19:6, and the priest shall take cedar wood and hyssop and scarlet. And the word here is taula, scarlet, scarlet worm. This is the scarlet. This is the crimson worm. This is the Coccus illicis. This is the scarlet worm. If you have not heard about the scarlet worm, brothers and sisters, be prepared. This is amazing. This is absolutely amazing, in my opinion. We're going to go to Psalm 22. My Elohim, my Elohim. This is known as the Psalm of the Cross. This is prophesying about Messiah on the cross. My God, my God, my Elohim, my El, right? When on in the Gospels, he's like, Eloi, 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 Eloi. And it's sometimes he's calling for Elias. Why have you forsaken me? Why are you far from helping me in the words of my roaring? Oh, my Elohim, I cry in the daytime, but you hear not, and in the night season, and I am not silent. But you are holy, O you that inhabit the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in you. They trusted in you did deliver them. They cried unto you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not confounded. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men, despised of the people. Now, let's take a look at this word worm here. But I am a worm, taula. I am a scarlet, crimson worm. He prophesied that he would be the scarlet, the taula. I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head, saying, he trusted on Yahuwah that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But you are he that took me out of the womb and did make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon you from the womb. You are my Elohim from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my jaws. And you have brought me into the dust of the death. For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me, they part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. You know, I think this is a really good time to remind ourselves what Messiah did. And we typically watch this during Day of Atonement, but I recently watched The Passion, and I know you can pick it apart and this and that, but you know what? Every time I see it, it reminds me of the beginning of my faith when I was at a low point in my life, ready to die, wanting to die, excuse me, and I called out, I just thought upon him being on that cross and sacrificing himself for us, being our sacrifice for sins and our redemption to him. And it changed my life. And, you know, we can really get deep into to the Torah, to the prophets, and learn all kinds of mysteries and new books. And, you know, brothers and sisters, we can never move away from the cross. I know some people say, ah, the cross is pagan. Well, I think they've turned it into a pagan thing, and they turned it into an idol. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But I believe our Messiah was nailed to a cross. I've gone back and forth, and I've looked to the stake, and I believe it was a cross. I do. But after reading Psalm 22, I just want to share this with you, and then I want to tie in how amazing this crimson worm, this towel of this crimson worm, and the tying into the red heifer is. So I'll see you in just about 6 minutes. parents, please forgive me. I didn't give you proper warning. I know sometimes children watch this. So the Psalm 22 says, but I am a worm. I am a taula. And we get the same thing here. The priest will take cedar wood and hyssop and taula and cast into the midst of the burning of the heifer. And this is where it gets kind of very interesting. We know, where is it? We know that at the crucifixion, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side. This is actually the wrong one. This is before that they put, they used hyssop. Where is it? I thought I had that. I probably put the wrong verse up here. This is where they parted his garments, right? Just like the psalm says. They cast lots. Here you go. Now there was a set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it upon hyssop. Maybe coincidence, maybe not. But if the cross was cedar wood, you've got the hyssop. Now the taula. And this is where it gets really interesting. The taula is the scarlet or crimson worm, the Coccus illis. And this is what Messiah proclaimed himself to be. And this is where it gets really interesting. Once we learn a little bit about the taula, the crimson worm. Usually in scriptures, the Hebrew word for a worm is rima, which means a maggot. But the Hebrew word Yahusha used here for worm is taula, which means crimson or scarlet worm. Both scarlet and crimson are the colors of blood, deep red. The crimson worm is a very special worm that looks more like a grub than a worm. When it is time for the female or mother crimson worm to have babies, when she does only one time in her life, she finds a tree, a trunk of a tree, a wooden fence post, or a stick. She then attaches her body to that wood and makes a hard crimson shell. She is so strongly and permanently stuck to the wood that the shell can never be removed without tearing her body completely apart and killing her. The crimson worm then lays her eggs under her body and the protective shell. When the baby worms or larvae hatch, they stay under the shell. Not only does the mother's body give protection for her babies, but it also provides them with food. The babies feed on the living body of the mother. After just a few days, when the young worms grow to the point that they are able to take care of themselves, the mother dies. As the crimson worm dies, she oozes a crimson or scarlet red dye, which not only stains the wood she's attached to, but also her young children. They are scarlet colored red for the rest of their lives. After 3 days, the dead mother crimson worm body loses its crimson color and turns into a white wax, which falls to the ground like snow. So what did Yahusha mean by saying, I am a worm? There are a lot of ideas Yahusha might have meant, but nobody really knows for sure. However, it's very interesting that just like the crimson worm, Yahusha sacrificed or gave up his life on a tree so that his children might be washed with his crimson blood and their sins cleansed white as snow. He died for us that we might live through him. I'm sorry, I think that's just too many coincidences, quote-unquote, for that to be just, well, coincidence. And there's your red heifer sacrifice. The cedar wood, the hyssop, the scarlet, and the unblemished heifer. I don't know. Okay, Numbers 20. Then came the children of Yisrael, even the whole assembly, into the desert of Zin in the first month, and the people abode in Kadesh, and Miriam died there and was buried there. And there was no water for the assembly, and they gathered themselves together against Moshe and against Aharon. And the people chode with Moshe and spoke, saying, would to Elohim that we had died when our brethren died before Yahuwah. And why have you brought up the assembly of Yahuwah into this wilderness, that we and our cattle should die there? And wherefore have you made us come up out of Mitzrayim to bring us into this evil place? It is no place of seed or figs or vines or pomegranates, neither is there any water to drink. And Moshe and Aharon went from the presence of the assembly unto the door of the tabernacle of the assembly, and they fell upon their faces, and the glory of Yahuwah appeared unto them. It just never ends, right? All Moshe and Aharon want to do is help the people, and all they want to do is just, like, cast their teeth at him and blame him for everything. Think about the kind of patience that they exhibited here. Think about the kind of patience that we need to exhibit in our lives. Sirach 2, 12 through 17. Woe to timid hearts and the slack hands and the sinner who walks along two ways. Woe to the faint heart, for it has no trust. So when we lose heart, we lose. It's like losing trust for him. Therefore, it will not be sheltered. Think about that crimson worm. Oof. Woe to you, have lost your endurance. What will you do when Yahweh punishes you? Those who fear Yahweh will not disobey his words, and those who love him will keep his ways. Those who fear Yahweh will seek his approval, and those who love him will be filled with the Torah. Those who fear Yahweh will prepare their hearts and will humble themselves before him. Praise Yah. All right, verse 7, Numbers 20, verse 7. Yahweh spoke unto El Moshe, saying, take the rod and gather the assembly together, you and Aharon your brother, and speak you unto the rock before their eyes, and it shall give forth his water. And ye shall bring forth to them water out of this rock. So shall ye give the assembly and their beasts to drink. So remember before, back in Exodus, he was told to strike the rock once and water will flow out. But this time he was told to just speak to the rock and it will come out. And Moshe took the rod from before Yahweh as he commanded him. And Moshe and Aharon gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said unto them, hear now, you rebels, must we fetch you water out of this rock. And so here is like the one, kind of the one time Moses loses his cool. And he kind of, because remember, he's a prophet and his words matter. He declared these people rebels, right? And so we should take heed to this and know what we say about others and kind of declaring what they are. Because our words have power. Hear now, you rebels, we must we fetch you water out of this rock. So Moses kind of loses his cool here. And I think most of us would have lost our cool by now. Numbers 20, verse 11. Moshe lifted up his hand with his rod, and he smote the rock twice, and the water came out abundantly, and the assembly drank, and their beasts drank also. And we read this earlier. What is it? But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came out there blood and water. And let me show you how this is interesting. In the Targums, there's something really interesting here. Where is it? And Moshe took the rod of the miracles from before Yahweh as he commanded him. And Moshe and Aharon gathered the congregation together before the rock. And Moshe said to them, hear now, rebels, is it possible for us to bring forth water for you from the rock? And Moshe lifted up his hand and with his rod struck the rock two times. At the first time it dropped blood, but at the second time there came forth a multitude of waters. One of the soldiers pierced to the side and forthwith came out blood and water. And we know that Messiah is that rock. We know that here in 1 Corinthians 10. And all did drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Messiah. But with many of them, Elohim was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. So, kind of interesting. And, you know, the Targums, they're not perfect. You know, they've got some, you know, added Jewish traditions in here stuff. So we do need to be very cautious as we read this stuff. But, you know, what are the odds? You know, I would venture to think that this was in the text and it was removed. First time it dropped blood, but then second time it dropped water. Because, you know, these Jewish rabbis knew all the stories about Messiah, and so I believe that they were like trying to cut as much of this out as possible. Just my opinion. And I don't say this enough anymore like I used to. You know, for those of you that are new, you know, I am simply sharing what I believe the Most High shows through study throughout the weeks and months and years. You know, it's up to you to study these out as well. I'm just sharing with you so to give you some nuggets to pray about to study for yourself. And I don't say that to say, you know, I'm not responsible for what I say, because I'm very responsible for what I say. And I know that people watch these and people are influenced by these, so I take great care to study and to show myself approved and to be careful what comes out of my mouth, because I know there's influence when I speak these things. But that's not to say that, you know, what I'm saying is I'm just a man and I can get things wrong, and I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm trying to be, and I'm trying to get my doctrine perfect. And for those of you that have watched these Torah portions, this is, I think, the fourth year we've gone on this Torah portion. Hopefully you see that I'm growing and maybe we get to grow together. And so I felt led to share that. Numbers 20, verse 12, and Yahweh spoke unto El Moshe and El Aharon, because you believe me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Yisrael. Therefore, you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them. And this is hard, because if you think about it, Moshe and Aaron didn't... Oh, Aaron messed up with the golden calf, and I'm not judging him, but Moshe really didn't mess up. He was kind of perfect. And this was his one mess up, and Yah's like, you're not going in the land. And that makes... This goes along with what I was just saying a second ago. James 3:1 says, not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with a greater strictness. And that puts a definite fear in my body, in my mind, in my ruach, and any of those. I know some of you that watch this have your own ministries as well, whether it just be like Facebook or Instagram or TikTok or whatever. That should make any of us who share and have any kind of influence over others tremble. I mean, look at Moses. He messed up once and was not able to go in. Think about that. Just think about that for a moment. All right. Numbers 20, verse 13. This is the waters of Meribah, because the children of Yisrael strove with Yahuwah, and he was sanctified in them. And Moshe sent messengers from Kadesh unto the king of Edom. Thus says your brother Yisrael, you know all the travail that has befallen us, how our fathers went down into Mitzrayim, and we have dwelt in Mitzrayim a long time. And the Mitzrayim vexed us, and our fathers. And when we cried unto El Yahuwah, he heard our voice, and sent an angel, and has brought us forth out of Mitzrayim. Behold, we are in Kadesh, a city in the uttermost of your border. Let us pass, I pray you, through your country. We will not pass through the fields, or through the vineyards, neither will we drink of the water of the wells. We will go by the king's highway. We will not turn into the right or the left, until we have passed your borders. And Edom said unto him, you shall not pass by me, lest I come out against you with a sword. And the children of Yisrael said unto him, we will go by the highway, and if I and my cattle drink of your water, then I will pay for it. I will only, without doing anything else, go through on my feet. And he said, you shall not go through. And Edom came out against him with much people and with a strong hand. Thus Edom refused to give Yisrael passage through his border, wherefore Yisrael turned away from him. And the children of Yisrael, even the whole assembly, journeyed from Kadesh and came unto Mount Hor. And Yahweh spoke unto El Moshe and El Aharon in Mount Hor by the coast of the land of Edom, saying, Aharon shall be gathered unto his people, for he shall not enter into the land which I have given unto the children of Yisrael, because you rebelled against my word at the water of Meribah. You rebelled against, right, Yahusha, the word. Take Aharon and Eleazar his son, and bring them up into Mount Hor, and strip Aharon of his garments, and put them upon Eleazar his son. And Aharon shall be gathered into his people, and shall die there. And Moshe did as Yahweh commanded, and they went up into Mount Hor in the sight of all the assembly. And Moshe stripped Aharon and his garments, and put them upon Eleazar his son, and Aharon died there in the top of the mount. And Moshe and Eleazar came down from the mount. And when all the assembly saw that Aharon was dead, they mourned for Aharon 30 days, even all the house of Yisrael. All right, Numbers 21, last chapter. And here you're going to see our Messiah again. So we saw him as the red heifer sacrifice, the crimson worm, the taula, and now we're going to see him as the bronze serpent. Or here in just a moment, actually. First, the Canaanite king. And when King Arad, the Canaanite, which dwelt in the Negev, heard tell that Yisrael came by the way of the spies, when he fought against Yisrael and took some of them prisoners, and Yisrael vowed a vow unto Yahuwah and said, if you will indeed deliver this people into my hand, then will I utterly destroy their cities. And Yahuwah hearkened to the voice of Yisrael and delivered up the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities, and called the place, named the place Hormah. This is where they had defeat earlier, but came back and got victory now. Now, the bronze serpent. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. The people spoke against Elohim and against Moshe, wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt, Mitzrayim, to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, for there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loathes this light bread. There's just always bickering at Moshe, and never satisfied, always got something to strive about. Always contentious, never any rest. And Yahuwah sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Yisrael died. Therefore the people came to Moshe and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against Yahuwah and against you. Pray unto El Yahuwah that he take away the serpents from us. And Moshe prayed for the people. See, this is Moshe's heart, right? He could just be like, yeah, right. You guys are always just like yelling at me and screaming at me and wanting to kill me and stone me. Go pray yourself. No, he didn't do that. Moshe prayed for the people. He writes, says that he's the meekest man. And Yahweh said unto Moshe, make you a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten when he looks upon it shall live. And Moshe made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and it came to pass that if the serpent had bit any man when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. And that's powerful. Most of you already know this passage right before John 3:16. John 3:14-15, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And this is when I say continually looking upon the cross, right? So it's like when I look upon the cross, you know, I see Messiah, you know, it's like that was like the moment, the beginning of this walk of coming to him, of truth, everything, that we can't get away from this. Can't do it. Cannot. It's kind of interesting here. Where is it? Here, 2 Kings. This eventually, remember I was saying earlier, the cross has become an idol, idolatry. People like kneel before and bow down to it. 2 Kings 18:1-4. Now it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. 25 years old was he when he began to reign, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of Yahuwah, according to all that David his father did. He removed the high places, and brake the images, and cut down the groves, and brake in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it, and he called it Nehushtan. So, the bronze serpent became an idol. And it's interesting that I do believe that Messiah was nailed on a cross, and the cross has become an idol. So, very interesting symbology here, right? It's like nothing new under the sun, as Solomon said in Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. What's happened before will happen again. It's also interesting that they've kind of taken, the enemy has kind of taken this bronze serpent idea and kind of made their own thing with a twisty serpent right here. What's this called? Like a Caduceus? Sounds like Sadducees, in my opinion. But anyways, it was a type and shadow foreshadowing Messiah, that he would heal us, that he would revive us. And of course, the, you know, devil likes to do his own deal here and take the truth and turn it into a lie. But it's really also really interesting because as we see here, the name of this bronze serpent was Nehushtan, which is very similar to Nachshon. Nehushtan, Nachshon. And I was asked, I was asked by Brother Dave, why Nachshon, which means enchanter, or really it could mean the bronze serpent, why, you know, that name was in the lineage of Messiah. And it's really interesting that if you look at the lineage of Messiah from Abraham all the way down to Messiah, you get a story. Like, so like Abraham means father of many. Isaac means he will laugh. Jacob means supplanter or circumvent or assail or heal. Judah means praise or be praised. Phares means breach or blossom. So on and so forth. So when you read the lineage, including Nachshon, which is very similar to Nehushtan, almost the same etymology here. This is the lineage of Messiah by using the names. The father of many, he will laugh. He will supplant and assail. He will be praised and blossom. A dart of joy, a division of song. He will be elevated, our kinsman of nobility. He is the bronze serpent, the oracle of Yah, clothed in a robe and mantle. In strength, he will be a servant and serve. My husband, our beloved, is peace. The people are enlarged, and Yah is my father. He is a man of sorrows and a ruler and governor. Yahuwah is exalted, and he is the power of Yah, the strength of Yah. Yahuwah is perfect and complete. He has grasped and possesses through Yahuwah's strengthening. Forgetting the multitudes of people, Yah heals and has possessed them. I have asked of Elohim to be pressed out of Babylon. A father of praise, Elohim sets up a helper, the righteous and just one, who is established and raised up. Elohim is majestic. Elohim has helped. He gave us a gift, the heel, the supplanter, and the increased double portion. And then Yahusha is Yahuwah saves. Kind of interesting. Maybe it's just a big coincidence. I don't know. I'm not sure. All right, Numbers 21:10. And the children of Yisrael said, so, long story short, right? Yahusha is the bronze serpent. So, let's take a moment. Let's each take 10, 15 seconds, and let's in our own quiet prayer, let's thank Yahuwah for our Messiah, Yahusha. And all the people said, Amen. Father, we thank you for Messiah Yahusha, who is our sacrifice for sin. He's our Passover lamb. He's all of your offerings. He's the red heifer. He's the bronze serpent. He's all of it, Father, all nestled here in your Torah, foreshadowing what he would do. In Yahusha's name, we bless you. Amen. All right. Back to Numbers 21. Verse 10. And the children of Yisrael set forward and pitched an ovot. And they journeyed from Ovot and pitched in Iye Havarim, in the wilderness which is before Moab, toward the sun rising. From thence they removed and pitched in the valley of Zered. And from thence they removed and pitched on the other side of Arnon, which is in the wilderness that comes out of the coast of the Amorim. For Arnon is the border of Moab, between Moab and the Amorim. Wherefore it is said in the Sefer of the Wars of Yahuwah, what he did in the Red Sea, in the brooks of Arnon. And the books of the Wars of Yahuwah, I believe, is Yashar, which we're going to read in a minute, because it expounds on this story and many of the story of the wars. And at the stream of the brooks that goes down to the dwelling of Ar and lies upon the borders of Moab. And from thence they went to Be'er, that is the well whereof Yahuwah spoke unto Moshe. Gather the people together, and I will give them water. Then Yisrael sang this song, Spring up, O well, sing ye unto it. The princes dug the well, the nobles of the people dug it, by the direction of the Torah giver, with their staves. That's interesting. Another reason we should all have a staff. And from the wilderness they went to Matana, and from Matana to Nachaliel, and from Nachaliel to Bamot, and from Bamot in the valley that is the country of Moab on the top of Pisgah, which looks towards Yeshimon. And Yisrael sent messengers unto Sihon, king of the Amorim, saying, Let me pass through your land, and we will not turn to the fields or into the vineyards. We will not drink of the waters of the well, but we will go along by the king's highway until we pay be past your borders. And Sihon would not suffer Yisrael to pass through his border, but Sihon gathered all his people together and went out against Yisrael into the wilderness, and he came to Yahatz and fought against Yisrael. And Yisrael smote him with the edge of the sword and possessed his land from Arnon unto Yabok, even unto the children of Ammon, for the border of the children of Ammon was strong. And Yisrael took all these cities, and Yisrael dwelt in all the cities of the Amorim, in Heshbon, and in all the villages thereof. For Heshbon was the city of Sihon, the king of the Amorim, who had fought against the former king of Moab, and taken all his land out of his hand, even unto Arnon. Wherefore they speak in Proverbs, saying, Come into Heshbon, let the city of Sihon be built and prepared. For there is a fire gone forth out of Heshbon, a flame from the city of Sihon, as it has consumed Ar of Moab, and Baalah of Bamoth of Arnon. Woe to you, Moab! You are undone, O people of Chemosh! He has given his sons that escaped and his daughters into captivity into Sihon, king of the Amorim. We have shot at them. Heshbon is perished, even unto Dibon, and we have laid them waste even unto Nanophah, which reaches unto Medeba. Thus Yisrael dwelt in the land of the Amorim, and Moshe sent to spy out Yaezer, and they took the villages thereof and drove out the Amorim that were there. And they turned and went up by the way of Bashan, and Og, king of Bashan, went out against them, he and all his people, to the battle of Edrei. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, Fear him not, for I have delivered him into your hand, and all his people, and all his land, and ye shall do unto him as ye did unto Sihon, king of the Amorim. These are giants, by the way, who dwelt at Heshbon. And they smote him, and his sons, and all his people, until there was none left alive, and they possessed all his land. And I'll just read this verse, and this ends the Torah portion, but we have some more to talk about. And the children of Yisrael set forward and pitched in the plains of Moab on this side of the Yordan by Jericho. So let's talk about the book of the Wars of Yahuwah that describes these events a little more in detail. We're going to look at the book of Yashar. We're going to read 85:1-33. And we're going to read a little more about these battles. And King Arad the Canaanite, who dwelt in the south, heard that the Israelites had come by the way of the spies, and he arranged his forces to fight against the Israelites. And the children of Israel were greatly afraid of him, for he had a great and heavy army. So the children of Israel resolved to return to Egypt. And the children of Israel turned back about the distance of 3 days, and journeyed into Masrath Benai Yakon, for they were greatly afraid on the account of King Arad. And the children of Israel would not get back to their places, so they remained in Benai Yakon for 30 days. And when the children of Levi saw that the children of Israel would not turn back, they were jealous for the sake of Yahuwah, and they rose up and fought against the Israelites, their brethren, and slew of them a great body, and forced them to turn back to their place, to Mount Hor. And they, when they returned, King Arad was still arranging his host for battle against the Israelites. And Israel vowed a vow, saying, "If you will deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities." And Yahuwah hearkened to the voice of Israel, and he delivered the Canaanites into their hand. And he utterly destroyed them and their cities, and called the name of the place Hormah. And the children of Israel journeyed from Mount Hor and pitched in Oboth, and they journeyed from Oboth and pitched in Ije Abarim, in the borders of Moab. And the children of Israel sent to Moab, saying, "Let us pass now through the land, through thy land, into our place." But the children of Moab would not suffer the children of Israel to pass through their land. For the children of Moab were greatly afraid, lest the children of Israel should do unto them as Sihon king of the Amorites had done unto them, who had taken their land and had slain many of them. Therefore Moab would not suffer the Israelites to pass through his land. And Yahuwah commanded the children of Israel, saying, that they should not fight against Moab. So the Israelites were removed from Moab. And the children of Israel journeyed from the border of Moab, and they came to the other side of Arnon, the border of Moab, between Moab and the Amorites, and they pitched in the border of Sihon, king of the Amorites, in the wilderness of Kedemoth. And the children of Israel sent messengers to Sihon, king of the Amorites, saying, "Let us pass through your land, and we will not turn into the fields or into the vineyards. We will go along by the king's highway until we have passed thy borders." But Sihon would not suffer the Israelites to pass. So Sihon collected all the people of the Amorites and went forth into the wilderness to meet the children of Israel, and he fought against Israel in Jahaz. And Yahuwah delivered Sihon, king of the Amorites, into the hand of the children of Israel, and Israel smote all the people of Sihon with the edge of the sword and avenged the cause of Moab. And the children of Israel took possession of the land of Sihon from Aram unto Yabbok and unto the children of Ammon, and they took all the spoil of the cities. And Israel took all these cities, and Israel dwelt in all the cities of the Amorites. And all the children of Israel resolved to fight against the children of Ammon, to take their land also. So Yahuwah said to the children of Israel, "Do not besiege the children of Ammon, neither stir up battle against them, for I will give nothing to you of their land." And the children of Israel hearkened to the word of Yahuwah, Messiah, and did not fight against the children of Ammon. And the children of Israel turned and went up by the way of Bashan to the land of Og, king of Bashan. And Og, the king of Bashan, went out to meet the Israelites in battle. And he had with him many valiant men and a very strong force from the people of the Amorites. And Og, king of Bashan, was a very powerful man. But Naaron, his son, was exceedingly powerful, even stronger than he was. And Og said in his heart, "Behold, now the whole camp of Israel takes up a space of 3 parsa. Now will I smite them at once, without sword or spear." And Og went up to Mount Yahaz, and took therefrom 1 large stone, the length of which was 3 parsa. And he placed it on his head, and resolved to throw it upon the camp of the children of Israel, to smite all the Israelites with that stone. And the angel of Yahuwah came and pierced the stone upon the head of Og, and the stone fell upon the neck of Og, that Og fell to the earth on account of the weight of the stone upon his neck. And at that time Yahuwah said to the children of Israel, "Be not afraid of him, nor have I, for I have given him and all his people and all his land into your hand, and you shall do to him as you did to Sihon." And Moses went down to him with a small number of the children of Israel, and Moses smote Og with a stick at the ankles of his feet and slew him. Remember, he was a giant, so he came up to him. Another reason to have a staff. This is reason number 2 in this Torah portion to have a staff. And the children of Israel afterward pursued the children of Og and all his people, and they beat and destroyed them till there was no remnant left of them. Moshe afterward sent some of the children of Israel to spy out Yazar, for Yazar was a very famous city. And the spies went to Yazar and explored it, and the spies trusted in Yahuwah, and they fought against the men of Yazar. And these men took Yazar and its villages, and Yahuwah delivered them into their hand, and they drove out the Amorites who had been there. And the children of Israel took the land of the 2 kings of the Amorites, 60 cities, which were on the other side of the Jordan, from the brook of Arnon into Mount Hermon. And the children of Israel journeyed and came into the plain of Moab, which is on this side of the Jordan by Jericho. So, interesting. And I think there's some stuff in the Targums we might want to read. Let's see here. Let's see here. Okay. So, chapter 21, we want to read the fourth one. So, 1, 2, 3... It says here, therefore did the word of Yahuwah send the basilisk serpents, right? And the people came to Moshe and said, we have sinned in thinking and speaking against the glory of Yahuwah's presence, and in contending with you, pray before Yahuwah to remove the plague of the fire serpents from us. And Moshe prayed for the people. This is sixth paragraph. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, make you a serpent of brass, and set it upon a place aloft. And it shall be that when a serpent has bit anyone, and if he behold it, then he shall live, if his heart be directed to the name of the word of Yahuwah. And Moshe, which is, we know, is Messiah, and Moshe made a serpent of brass and set it upon a place aloft. And it was, when a serpent had bitten a man, and the serpent of brass was gazed at, and his heart was intent upon the name of the word of Yahuwah, he lived. I mean, just doesn't get any better than that. So we're going to go, let's see, this is paragraph 7, 8, 9, 10, here, now 11. And then sent Israel messengers to Sihon, king of the Amorites, saying, I would pass through your country. We will not carry off the betrothed, nor seduce virgins, nor have to do with the wives of men. By the highway of the king who is in the heavens we will go, until we have passed through thy border. But Sihon would not permit Israel to pass through his limit, but constrained all his people, and came to Jahaz, and made war against Israel. And Israel smote him with the anathema of Yahuwah that would destroy him, with the edge of the sword, and took possession of his country. I don't know why I read that one. That one's not really different. Let's see. Let's see here. Oh, here we go. Then they turned and went up by the way to Mathan, and Og, king of Mathan, or Bashan, came out to meet us, he and all his people, to give battle at Edrei. And it was, when Moshe saw Og, he trembled before him, stricken with fear. But he soon answered and said, this is Og, the wicked, who taunted Abraham our father and Sarah, saying, you are like trees planted by the water channels, but bring forth no fruit. Therefore has the Holy One, blessed be he, spared him to live through the generations, that he might see the great multitude of their children and be delivered into our hands. Then spake Yahuwah unto Moshe, fear him not, for I have delivered him into your hand, and all his people in his country, and you shall do to him as you have done unto Sihon, king of the Amorites of Heshbon. Now it was, after Og the wicked had seen the camp of Israel spreading over 6 miles, he said within himself, I will make war against this people, that they may not do to me as they done to Sihon. So went he and tear up a mountain 6 miles in size, and brought it upon his head to hurl it upon them. But the word of Yahuwah forthwith prepared a reptile which ate into the mountain and perforated it, and his head was swallowed up within it, and he sought to withdraw it, but could not, because his back teeth and his front ones were drawn hither and thither. So maybe a little exaggeration, but you can see how it's a very similar story as what's going on in Yashar, with just different details. And Moshe went and took an axe of 10 cubits, and sprang 10 cubits, and struck him on the ankle of his foot, and he fell and died beyond the camp of Israel. So here we have a second witness to the basic story of premise of what's going on in Yashar. Thus it is written, and they smote him and his sons and his daughters and all his people, till none of them remained to escape, and they took possession of his land. Kind of interesting. Very interesting. So, brothers and sisters, that is our Torah portion for this week, and the next week will be Balak and Balaam, the talking donkey. So, I meant to mention earlier that I apologize. I do not monetize the videos anymore, but that video that I do, it has copyright from the people that made the Passion, so they're going to copyright this video, and they're going to put I don't do the monetization, because I don't want these ads. Sometimes these ads on these videos are disgusting, and I don't like mixing that with Yah's word. And so I unfortunately, I think ads might show up on this, not because I put that on, but because I put copyrighted material on this video, and so I apologize ahead of time if there's commercials on here. So any case, with that being said, just want to, I'm so sorry, we haven't gotten the sign up the registration form up on the website for Sukkot yet. We're working on it, but just go ahead and make your plans, and we'll have registration open soon. And for Sukkot, which is, if you don't know, it's August 10th through the 18th, but I think we'll be camping the 9th through the 19th, I think. Like 10 days camping, I think. So, and it's going to be in Lebanon, Missouri. So stay tuned for that. So let's pray. Father Yahuwah, we bless you and praise you, Father, for sending your son Yahusha, our king, the rock in the wilderness, Father, the one that gives us life, Father. And we just acknowledge him as the red heifer sacrifice, the crimson worm, the bronze serpent, Father. And we just thank you so much. And we just ask that you continue to open our eyes and ears to your Torah, that we may be faithful followers and not just hearers of your word, Father. We want to be found righteous when Messiah Yahusha comes back. And we know that we can only be righteous by the blood of Messiah. And we strive to do what's right in your sight. Father, help us, guide us in the path, and lead us, let us neither go to the left or to the right hand of your word. In Yahusha's mighty name, we bless and praise you. Amen and hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, brothers and sisters. We'll do a couple songs and we'll end this. So, shalom.
Let's sing a little song about the two greatest commandments, loving Yahuwah and loving people. Let's start with how we love him.
You shall not have any other Elohim before him. You shall not have any graven images, for you are his. Shall not bow down to them, nor shall you ever serve them.
Keeping his commandment shows you love him. Yahusha did not abolish but strengthen them. Blessed are those who keep his way. They may have the right to enter.
His name in vain, and remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Work 6 days and then we rest and be refreshed. Honor your mom and dad, and then you'll be surely glad.
Keeping his commandment shows you love him. Yahusha did not abolish but strengthen them. Blessed are those who keep his way. They may have the right to enter through the gate.
Now we're going to sing about loving other people. Here's how.
And you shall not murder anyone, even in your heart. Love everyone, and you shall not commit adultery, even in your mind. Put that all behind, and you shall not steal anything. Be satisfied with what Yah provides, and you shall not tell any lies, for he sees all who's above the skies. You shall not covet anything, but keep his ways. You won't lack a thing.
Keeping his commandment shows you love him. Yahusha did not abolish, but strengthen them. Blessed are those who keep his way. They may have the right to enter through the gate.
Thank you. us of your Son so we could have hope. Taught us how to walk in spirit and in truth. He is the vine, through him we bear fruit. Your word's a lamp unto our feet, our heart's desire with every single beat. Your Torah inside us, commandments we know. Till that creature far, we wait until it's gone.
When you said, seeking my face, my heart said unto you, your face will I see, and sound at shofar, and go on the shout, we'll sing you praises, praises to our King, and clap your hands, all his people.
We're at the end and surely we know. The world is filled with lies, vanities and woes. The people that seek him turning to his way, leaving Babylon, Yahushua, don't delay. Hearken, O his people, his doctrine drops his rain. Keeping the commandments lest you walk in vain. His Torah is no burden no matter what you're told. Sweeter than honey and worth more.
My heart said unto you, your face will I see, and sound that shofar, and go with the shout, we'll sing you praises, praises to our King, and clap your hands, all his people, and sing with joy.
Standing on Mount Zion, singing the new song. Yahushua and his chosen, to him we belong. Worthy is the Lamb, for he was slain. Made us kings and priests, by him we shall reign. Open ye the gates for those that keep the truth. You give us lasting peace, our minds are stayed on you. Striving to shine bright like your menorah. Walking in the way, the truth, your Torah.
I'll never go back.
Never go back.
I'll never leave you.
Never leave you.
I'll never go back.
Never go back.
To my own way.
To my own way.
I'll seek your face.
Seek your face.
For all of my days.
For all of my days.
You've given me peace.
You've given me peace.
By teaching your said unto you, your face will I see, and sound that shofar, and go with the shout, we'll sing you praises, praises to our King, and clap your hands, all his people.